أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته
الله
I would like to welcome all of you who have braved this weather and chose to come here for this important lecture. We commend your attention and inshallah may Allah help us to be benefited from today's lecture. Alhamdulillah. We all know that Islam is the complete way of life. But are we really practicing this complete way of life? As far as our iman goes, our belief goes, and our ibadat goes, I can say that, alhamdulillah, by and large, we are following it. But as far as our social system is there, family system is there, economic system is there, political system is there, and the complete code of life is there, I don't know how much we are following it. And to bring this home, we have started this series with our very able speaker, internationally known, and we call him Abu Talha. You have heard him, so I'm not going to go into the details of his achievements and his abilities and skills and experience. Without a further ado, I would give it to Dr. Abu Talha, and who is going to be expounding on the social system of Islam. And inshallah, this lecture will be for 45 to 50 minutes. After that, we'll have about 35 to 40 minutes of question and answer. This brother, we are thankful that he is amongst us, not only braving this weather, but he has a flight to catch at 9 o'clock. So we'll respect his schedule and his time, and we thank and we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah make his journey easy and successful, which is coming up, inshallah, in a few hours. So, inshallah, brothers and sisters, it's my pleasure and honor to present to you Dr. Abu Talha.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulihi al-kareem, wa alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen, hamda shakirin. Rabbi shrah li sadri wa yassir li amri wa hlul 'uqdatan min lisani yafqahu qawli. Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, dear brothers and sisters. May Allah Azza wa Jal reward all of you and all of us for taking the time to talk and discuss about vital Islamic issues that are of major concern for all of us. Anything that is from Islam, based on Islam, comes from the aqidah of Islam, is of significance and importance to us. So whether it's the social system, the political system, the economic system, whether it's the rituals, the prayers, the fasting, the hajj, all of it is from Allah Azza wa Jal, and whatever comes from Allah, whatever comes from Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we take it humbly, and we worship Allah Azza wa Jal by talking about it, discussing it, implementing it, abiding by it, and propagating it, inshallah. So the topic of the social system, it's an involved topic. I don't think I will do the service, the good service, in this short period of time, but it's an eye-opening for the issues that are involved. So what I will be discussing tonight, inshallah, as time permits, I will go over the essence of the social system. What do we mean by that? What does it cover? What is it related to? Perspective on women coming from different perspectives, Islam and non-Islam. The relationships that existed between women and men pre-Islam, when Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam received the message. How it was at the time, what was happening in this from this perspective. And then I will talk a little bit about the social system under secular, liberal, democratic, capitalistic systems which are not based on Islam, what happens? And then we will go over major issues. How does Islam prevent the social system? That's the overall structure of the talk tonight. Now, in the the issues which are related to the social system. Let me just give this brief introduction here, that in our life as humans, all of our lives, we seek to perform transactions and to do activities and to get in relationships with one another for the very purpose of to satisfy our needs. We have specific needs. We have our food, drinks, our instincts of survival, our instinct to continue the human race, our instincts to worship Allah Azza wa Jal. All of these are natural drives. That is how we interact in our life. That's what we do in order to satisfy those needs which are internal, intrinsic. This boy, whenever he is hungry, he has to talk to someone to go home to look for his mother. He needs to eat. That's a transaction. If at any point of time the young kid, his parents are angry with him, so he has to maneuver somehow to be able to get around, to get the game he wants to play with, the food he wants to eat, the money spending he needs. All these are issues which are directly related to the internal needs, internal interests, internal instincts. Now, some of these instincts and some of the drives that drive us to do things, they have to do with the general life irrespective of the gender. Meaning, there is the, and to be specific here, the instinct of survival, I call it. This is the thing that pushes me and drives me to live and to sustain my life. That type of instinct and that type of drive pushes me to interact with people, buy, sell, exert some labor, work, be employed, get in partnerships, all of this so that at the end of the day, I secure a living, I secure my life, if you will. And all of these transactions that have to do with this survivalistic instinct, with this life, they do not distinguish from the perspective that you are dealing a man with a woman or a woman with a man. If you are buying, if a woman goes to the market, she buys something for some food for her home, she doesn't do that as a woman. She does that as a human, a person who needs to get food for her family. It's not as a female. And the man or the male, if you go to work and you get employed, you don't get employed as a male. You get employed as a human being who wants to get employed and get work and to survive. Now, all of these transactions which are related to the life of a human as such, they fall under what we discussed earlier, the economic financial system. So economic system, financial system, it deals with all those transactions and relationships that exist between people in order to sustain their life. Now, however, there is certain instinct in the human, whether a man or a woman, there is an instinct that drives one and the other in order to mate, in order to breed, in order to continue the human race. There is an instinct that Allah Azza wa Jalla created within us. In fact, He created it within all species. That Allah Azza wa Jalla خلق الأزواج كلها. He created almost everything in couples. This coupling, the fact that there are couples, this is intrinsic instinct. This is something that Allah Azza wa Jal created in us, within us, as people, and as much as He created it within other species. There are this coupling thing, and this coupling has its own drives. So the man is driven naturally to seek a woman, the woman is driven naturally to seek a man. At the end of the day, in order to sustain not the personal life, but the human race. Because my personal life, the way I sustain my personal life, I have to work. I have to get food or I have to protect myself. But in order to protect my race, to get some children and grandchildren and descendants, then you need the couple. So that is the relationship that exists between men and women, the relationships that exist between men and women, which are geared towards or which are based on the fact that these couples, men and women, they need to continue their race. The relationship and the transactions that come there, they fall under what we call the social system. What this really means is if people get together in the market in order to buy and sell for commerce purpose, then the problems that need to be resolved there are the problems of economic nature or financial nature. But if the meeting between men and women, especially between couples, is meant to continue the human race or to satisfy that instinct of kind, if you will, then there are certain problems which need to be resolved on their own, and this falls under what we call the social system. So that's why when we say the social system, we discuss the issues which are related to men and women in their interactions as males and females. As males and females, not as a human and a human only. They are both humans, but from this perspective that they are male and female. Now, having said that, let me emphasize that the issue when the people, especially in the West, they talk about the plight of women, the woman problem. There is, in Islam, we do not have something called the problem of a woman, or the woman problem, or the woman case. We have a problem of man, of human as such. The problem of insan, you have to resolve the issues of an insan who is the human, man or woman. But there isn't anything peculiar to say these are issues pertain to women. But there are issues pertain to the social relations between men and women, which comes under the form of marriage, divorce, children, parenthood, motherhood, relationships, relatives, all of these relations that come under the so-called the social structure of men and women. So with this introduction, I just want to emphasize that when we talk about the social system, we are not focusing or interested or concentrating on the economic part of it or the financial part of it or the political part of it. Those are issues which are important and they are discussed within their scope from Islamic perspective, of course, and they do pertain to both men and women equally likely. When we talk about financial transactions or economic transactions or political transactions, we do not say this is for man or woman. This is for insan in general. In fact, Allah Azza wa Jal makes this clear in the Quran when he talks about the issues that pertain to the loyalty, to the devotion, to the taqwa, to the sabr, to the prayer. He keeps saying male or female, man or woman, الصابرين والصابرات, الصائمين والصائمات, الذاكرين الله والذاكرات, الحافظين فروجهم والحافظات. All of this, the male doing this and the female doing that, the same act, the same issue. So there is no distinction in Islam when it comes to other transactions other than the social system part. That is the essence of the topic here. Now, having said that, let me go and see when Islam arrived. Now, we know Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he received the revelation. Before that, there was no religion in Arabia. The remainder of Ibrahim, whatever the people have remembered from Ibrahim alayhi salam, they had Al-Kaaba around them, but to them Al-Kaaba did not mean anything related to Allah Azza wa Jal. It's a place where they have idols, it's a place where they exploit the people coming to make Hajj just like they do sometimes these days. But it's not really an issue of a specific religion. So the Arabs then, at that time, not having a specific relation to Allah Azza wa Jal and not being well versed in the religion, let's say, of Christianity or Judaism that were in the surrounding. Jewish were in Medina, Christians were in Najran in Yemen or in the Roman Empire. But in general, the Arabs at that time At the time when Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam received the revelation, they had formulated their own views of what man and woman are and what how they should engage in relationships. And there was the least which can be said, there was chaos. In Mecca, in Arabia, in the Arabian Peninsula, there was chaos. There was no order. And that is explained and narrated by Aisha radiallahu anha in several hadiths. And I will scan some of those type of relationships that existed at the time when Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came. And do we have a view there? Looks like I think there is something. Is that better now? No. Okay. Let me just see what I can do here. No. Because I need to go to the left. Sorry. I did maximize it here.
Yeah, that's much better now.
Yeah. Is it? Oh, okay.
Okay.
Okay. Now, before I go to how the Arabs looked at the woman, let's see. In fact, before Islam, how the people looked at the woman, the perspective. And of course, we know that Allah Azza wa Jal, when He told us in the Quran, that He definitely stated that Allah Azza wa Jal created the human, created an insan, created Adam, and that He breathed into him from his soul. وَنَفَخْتُ فِيهِ مِنْ رُوحِي. And Allah Azza wa Jal did not distinguish that this ruh that Allah breathes in human, it's only man related or human or woman related. Whereas in medieval ages, later, and of course even before Islam, there was a debate always. There has always been a debate about whether the woman does have the same soul as a man or not. In Islam, we don't have this debate. Islam never, in fact, irrespective of how diverse the philosophy of Islam has come throughout the last 1400 years, Muslims never engaged in a debate or a discussion whether a woman has the same soul, the same nafs, the same structure as man or not. Whereas this type of discussion or this debate had always been within other cultures, within other societies, within our ideologies, including those which were based on Christianity, not the real Christianity, of course. Allah Azza wa Jal would never reveal to Isa alayhi salam or to tell him that women are different creatures or species than men. So we know that this type of view on women is, in Islam, it's pure and it's clear. On non-Islam, it's not pure, it's not clear. In fact, also, when I was searching this, I was looking deeply to see this issue of the so-called who is responsible for the sin of humans. In Christianity, it is a common knowledge. It's a common knowledge. Now, some of them, they do disagree among their scholars, but it's common knowledge that when Allah Azza wa Jal created Adam, and He asked him to live in Jannah with his wife, that He created from him. Then in Christianity it says that it is Eve or Hawa, the woman who accepted the whisper from the snake or from Iblis or from the Shaitan, and she is the one who conveyed the message to Adam, and Adam did eat from the tree based on her on what she said. And that is something they talk about, they discuss, and some people take it as, or the woman is responsible for evicting humanity out of the Jannah. Now we know in the Quran, Allah Azza wa Jal clearly states that فَوَسْوَسَ لَهُ, that the shaitan waswas for Adam. He made the whisper into Adam. And then it says فَعَصَى آدَمُ رَبَّهُ فَغَوَى. Adam is the one who disobeyed Allah Azza wa Jal. It's not his wife. So that so-called guilt, historical guilt, the guilt that continues to propagate throughout history of mankind, in Islam that issue does not exist. So the issue of woman per se, as part of this structure of the social system. The Islam is clear on it, Islam is pure on it, Islam does not even have the debate. We never teach it to our children, we never talk to our kids. Oh, this is was the woman who convinced her husband in order to eat from that tree. That in Islam doesn't exist. In Christianity it does, in Judaism it does, in the Old Testament, in the cultures which have revolved or evolved from the Western cultures, they do have all these type of mythologies about the role of women for evicting people or humans out of Jannah. So we don't. We just have to make, to set this clear, and to make sure that we never confuse this issue in Islam. And Allah Azza wa Jal in the Quran, this ayah where he says, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ اتَّقُوا رَبَّكُمُ الَّذِي خَلَقَكُم مِّن نَّفْسٍ وَاحِدَةٍ. Fear your Rabb, your Allah, the one who created you from one single soul, as the same. وَخَلَقَ مِنْهَا زَوْجَهَا. And he created its, from this soul its mate or its couple. So they, now they are a couple. وَبَثَّ مِنْهُمَا رِجَالًا كَثِيرًا وَنِسَاءً. And he distributed among them so many men and women. And that's an indication here for what I mentioned earlier, the instinct of the continuation of the human race. Allah Azza wa Jal makes this coupling in a manner that the human race will continue with many, multiple men and women coming out of these people. So that is something, and Allah Azza wa Jal repeats that time and time again in another place. Allah created from the same soul its mate. So that, I will not go through all of these ayat, we go through them, you know them, we go through the Quran. But every time you say that Allah Azza wa Jal created out of the nafs, out of the soul, its mate. So the mate or the couple, zawjaha, he says from a nafs, he created its zawj. So whether it's a male first or female first, there is no emphasis. The emphasis on the fact that it's one single soul and the other part is made to the same soul. So it's not two distinct souls, two distinct nafs. That notion we do not have. Now let me go to the, just to start to list the way the Arabs used to deal with this issue of men and women before Islam. There are many things here, but I'm not going to go through them. Now remember, the time when Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam received the revelation, it was called the time of jahiliyyah. Jahiliyyah means based on ignorance. Ignorance means it's not based on a solid foundation. That's what ignorance. Because ignorance does not necessarily mean I don't know anything. But ignorance means whatever I know as a fact, I don't use it in my life. That's ignorance. That's even worse of ignorance. Today, societies of the world, they know a lot. They know much more than anyone can expect them to know. But they do not base their behavior or their perspectives on facts and on knowledge. They base it based on their desire, based on their hawa. That's ignorance. So that's why the society of Mecca used to be called the society of ignorance. And they had those mythologies. For example, number one is a woman when she is born, it's a source of a trouble and a source of burden upon the society. Unless a woman is absolutely protected, is from the highest class of the society, then that woman is a source of burden. It's a source of shame. It's a source of trouble for the people. That's why Allah Azza wa Jal depicted this issue in the Quran where he says, وَإِذَا الْمَوْءُودَةُ سُئِلَتْ بِأَيِّ ذَنْبٍ قُتِلَتْ. People used to kill their daughters. They would take a daughter and would kill her. Would kill her by burying her alive. And this is the irony that the people don't want to kill. It's too much. I don't want to kill my daughter. But they still put her in a well and they pour dirt on top of her until she dies. Now he is not, he says, oh, I did not kill the girl. She just died on her own. وَإِذَا الْمَوْءُودَةُ سُئِلَتْ بِأَيِّ ذَنْبٍ قُتِلَتْ. Allah Azza wa Jal says, actually they are killing their daughters in this manner. In another place, where he says, وَإِذَا بُشِّرَ أَحَدُهُمْ بِالْأُنْثَى ظَلَّ وَجْهُهُ مُسْوَدًّا وَهُوَ كَظِيمٌ. When someone is told that your wife just gave a birth to a daughter, to a female, ظَلَّ وَجْهُهُ مُسْوَدًّا, his face will be blackened. وَهُوَ كَظِيمٌ, and he's absolutely sad and uncomfortable and feeling very bad. He doesn't like that. يَتَوَارَى مِنَ الْقَوْمِ, he's trying to hide his face from the people. مِنْ سُوءِ مَا بُشَّرَ بِهِ, because he cannot take it that somebody telling him, oh, you have a daughter in the family, it's too much. What is he going to do? أَيُمْسِكُهُ, shall he keep that daughter? أَمْ يَدُسُّهُ بِالتُّرَابِ, or shall he plug it in dirt in a well and bury that? That is how the society of Mecca was at the time when Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came. That's their perspective on women. So now, what we see, some people, they debate whether woman has, whether she's an evil, whether she has a spirit of a dog, or the spirit of shaitan, or she doesn't have the spirit of a human. And some other people, they think that woman is a source of evil, and a source of shame, and a source of burden upon the society, so they kill her. And Allah Azza wa Jal, he made this ayah, وَإِذَا الْمَوْءُودَةُ سُئِلَتْ بِأَيِّ ذَنْبٍ قُتِلَتْ, in Surah Al-Takwir, in the same surah, where Allah talks about those big signs, إِذَا الشَّمْسُ كُوِّرَتْ, when the sun is going to explode, وَإِذَا السَّمَاءُ انْكَدَرَتْ, when the heavens fall down, and when the seas explode, when the stars fall down, all this. And then he says, and the daughter, the buried alive daughter, she will be asked about why was she killed. Allah Azza wa Jalla equates the burying of a child alive, a daughter, especially a daughter, nobody buries the kids, the boys, the daughter. He equated that with those big events of the destruction of the universe in the upcoming of Yawm Al-Qiyamah. There was the fall of the sky, the fall of the heavens, the fall of the stars, the explosion of the seas, the burning of the seas, the burning or the explosion of the sun, all of these big signs, and the daughter who was buried alive will be raised up, and she will be asked, why did they kill you? That is just to show how the Quran and how Islam was so furious about this act, about this relation or this view of the woman. Now, as I said, based on how the Arabs, they were chaotic society, jahiliyyah, ignorance, the way they used to deal with relations. How do they deal with, what is their so-called marriages or coupling? They have more than 8 or 9 different types of relations, and all of them were legal, valid, acceptable, normal. Everybody performs them in the same without any hesitation. One type of marriage, they call it nikahul maqt. Al maqt called odious or shameful marriage. They call it odious. They call it nikahul maqt. They call it, but they do it. Now this is what I've just mentioned earlier. People do know knowledge, do have knowledge, facts, but they do not base their behavior based on that knowledge. So they call it al-maqt, they call it odious, they call it shameful, they call it bad, but nevertheless they do it. And this is the time when someone will take his father's wife and marry his father's wife, and then whatever children she has from the previous, from his father becomes his sons. So his brothers become his sons. And so this, they used to call it al-maqt because they didn't like it. They didn't think it's right, but then nevertheless they did it. And Allah Azza wa Jal, when the Quran was revealed, told Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and us, وَلَا تَنْكِحُوا مَا نَكَحَ آبَاؤُكُمْ مِنَ النِّسَاءِ, do not get married to whomever your parents, your fathers have married to. Like someone, let's say my father had took a second wife, or my mother died and he married another one. And then after my father dies, I do not marry my so-called stepmother. That is not allowed in Islam. That is to keep this human race and this continuation of descendants and children, grandchildren, all of it is in order, so that we don't get this confused type of relationships. There is the other type of marriage, which is called nikah al-mut'a, or marriage of joy. Now, although marriage of joy or marriage of mut'a, which is until today it's practiced or acceptable by the Ja'fari sects or by the Shia sect. But nevertheless, before Islam, this was common. And it was a form, before Islam, it was a form of getting engaged with a lady, with a woman, for a particular time. 1 hour, 1 day, 1 week, 1 month, it doesn't matter how much, but for a very specific time, and then the marriage has expiration date. So you marry a woman and it expires that marriage within a certain period of time. When Islam, during Islam, the Prophet ﷺ, there was a time, he told the people, the Muslims, you can do that for a specific period, and then later on, as narrated by Ali radiallahu anhu, which is very interesting, this is, I wish the our brothers from the Shia sect, they would hear that, because Imam Ali himself, he narrates, and it is in Bukhari, that Imam Ali radiallahu anhu says, he told Ibn Abbas, Ibn Abbas asked him the question, so Ali tells Ibn Abbas, إِنَّ النَّبِيَّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ نَهَى عَنِ الْمُتْعَةِ وَعَنْ لُحُومِ الْحُمُرِ الْأَهْلِيَّةِ زَمَنَ خَيْبَرٍ. During the battle of Khaybar, he told the people, stop doing mut'a, stop doing this marriage for a specific time. There is the other type of marriage which the Arabs, the Jahiliyyah, used to do, they call it the exchange or al-badal. Al-badal, it is something that's practiced today in the Western society. Families, couples, they exchange wives. They just say, I like your wife, you like my wife, let's exchange. They exchange it either permanently or temporarily, or just for one time. And this was something they practiced, and it was common in the society of Mecca, or within the Arab society, not only Mecca. And of course, Allah Azza wa Jal, He condemned that. And He told the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, لا يحل لك النساء من بعد ولا أن تبدل بهن. You cannot exchange wives. لا تبدل, التبديل means you exchange wives with someone else. This is called زواج البدل. And that was something common in the society of Mecca. There is the marriage for genetic improvement. I use this word genetic improvement for a lack of a better English translation. In Arabic called al-istibda'. Al-istibda' in Arabic called. Now al-istibda', or what I translated as genetic improvement, it's a very strange type of marriage where someone would marry a woman and the person and his wife are not from the highest class of the society. They are not from Bani Hashim, let's say. Then they would say, okay, what do we do in order to have good kids? So the husband now, he allows his wife to say, why don't you go and sleep with that person, let's say Abu Lahab or Abu Jahl or Al-Walid bin Mughira. And the reason I'm using these names, because you tell why these people, they went against Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because they used to enjoy their life. Young women getting married, and they come to sleep with them in order to produce kids which are of highest class. It's called al-istibda'. يقول لها اذهبي إلى فلان فاستبضعي منه. Go to this person and get yourself pregnant from him. That is absolutely outrageous type of marriage, and this was common in the society of Mecca. There is the group marriage, which is common, also known for a woman to receive multiple men at the same time, and then when those group of people, less than 10 or 10, they go and sleep with the woman, when she gets pregnant, then she either gets to choose and select which one is the husband, is the father, or they would do what they call it, they make a draw out of that with the luck. They say, you give numbers, everybody pick a number, okay, you are the father. That is something they used to do. And then there is also the official legal prostitution within that society, where the women who would deal with all types of illegal activities would raise a flag on top of her home. Then people would know this is ashabul sahibatul rayat. This is a woman of a flag. A woman of a flag, she's accepting all types of relations with others. Then there is also the slave prostitutes. Slave prostitutes, the owner of a slave or of a woman would force her to go and commit the zina, commit the acts in order to get money out of her. That is in New York, in Chicago, in many places, people would see them around, and they call them, they have a name for them. Their names, I think they call them pimps, or they call them whorehouses, or whatever. They do have, that practice was in the society of Mecca. And then there is the woman inheritance. If somebody dies, a husband dies, then his belonging get inherited and his wife is inherited. So the wife is treated as a commodity. She will be inherited, and then those who inherit the husband from the male side, they either would give her into marriage to one of his brothers or cousins or whoever, or keep her not getting married, or a couple of them would marry her. That's the case. In so those were the cases, and there are other cases narrated in Ibn Kathir and al-Tabari on all of this chaos that was going in Mecca. Now, when Islam came, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Allah azza wa jal, they put limits to these. Number one, they prohibited the zina altogether. Zina, fornication, adultery, any sexual relations outside the marriage are absolutely prohibited, absolutely categorically not allowed, and Allah Azza wa Jal condemned that, and he mentioned وَلَا تَقْرَبُوا الزِّنَا إِنَّهُ كَانَ فَاحِشَةً وَسَاءَ سَبِيلًا. Don't even come close to zina. This is fahisha, this is shameful, this is bad, and it's a bad way, it's a bad path, it's a wrong path to take. And as I mentioned a few minutes ago, one of the reasons the top elites in Mecca, they opposed Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they were called al-mukathibina ulil na'ma. They are the people of power because they enjoyed this lifestyle, and they benefited from that lifestyle. They benefited from the istibda', they benefited from selling their slaves, their slave women into prostitution. They benefited from that in making sure that they can enjoy all types of their desires without any restrictions, and they could. They had the power to do that. Now, having said all of that, I just want to mention that today's societies, when we skip the era of Islam for a second, in the society that's today based on separation of religion and the state, not only church, a society that took out Allah Azza wa Jal out of the picture, a society that decided to live that with so-called personal freedom. What is personal freedom? In reality, it means I do whatever I think is suitable for me at this time. Whatever is pleasant for me, I will do it. I don't need the restrictions that come from external sources, and that external sources is God, Allah Azza wa Jal. That is the liberalism, that's the secularism, that is the individualism, that's the capitalism, that's the democracy. Call it whatever name you want, but at the end of the day, it is get out or lift out all of the restrictions that come from Allah Azza wa Jal, and let people do whatever they want to do. Now, the result of once we do something like this, you will have same sex marriage, same gender marriage, being legalized day after day, state after state, and eventually it will be legalized at the federal level. It has been legalized in many places in Europe. The so-called, the purest, the more pure secularists become, because secularism, sometimes it's not that pure. They have impurity in secularism. What's the impurity? You still have some ideas, some thoughts from religion, from Christianity or Judaism or Islam, so it's not pure. So the purest, the more pure you become in secularism, just like in Netherlands, in Denmark, those who were more advanced in secularism and liberalism than the United States, they had same-sex marriage much more earlier than here. Now we are catching up. We are catching up. This is part of the deal of the so-called the social relations that exist in societies which are not based on Islam, which are based on secularism, based on liberalism and individualism. They have the all types which I talked about them in the Arab society. Almost each and every one is replicated today. Each and every one. Prostitution. Houses which are legalized. Of course, they are legalized. Some of them, they are not legalized because of the tax purposes, not because they don't allow them, but because they want to make sure that anyone who earns money, whether it's for selling body or selling phones, you have to pay taxes for that. So the moment they can control the taxation part of it, then it's halal. Then you will get the so-called the prostitution going on. The exchanges, go to Facebook, to Google, and look at all of these episodes about people going into parties where they have, they're mixed at the end of the party when everybody is drunk, everybody goes out with whomever woman he wants, and then the next day, the day after, they have to sort this, to sort things out. Each mother, each woman goes back to her husband, each husband goes back to his wife, but the previous night everybody was with everybody else. That's the current, and I don't want to dwell on this a lot. We know that, we know the history here, we know the statistics, we know all the things about the chaos and the social relations, but I will talk about the impact now. What does it do to us? Now that impact, it comes in all types of form. And there are statistics, which I will show here, the births to unmarried women, especially in the countries that have secularism and liberalism and democracy at its highest. In the United States, births, children born to a woman where the father is unknown, or the father doesn't care, or the father goes to jail, or it's a rape, or it doesn't matter what the reason is. It jumped from 18% in 1980 to 40% in 2008. In Canada, from 12 to 30. Look at Sweden, from 40% to 55%. Sweden is one of the most liberal countries. So then immediately you could tell this is the direct consequence of liberalism. Divorce rate and marriages in those liberal secular countries. Between 1980 and 2008, the United States, the marriage rate was 16 in 1,000, the number 16 per 1,000 population, you have 16 marriages. In 2008 was reduced to 10, and their divorce rate, of course, went down because the marriage is down. It's not because we are not divorcing anymore, because we don't have as much marriage as we used to do before. And the same thing goes for almost all of these top secular liberal nations which are being played as role model for the rest of the world. Single parent household, the reason I brought this is because it has to do with eventually with money, with wealth, with poverty. If someone is, especially women, and when they talk single parent household, mostly those are run by women, not by men. Mostly a single woman who is running her own household, taking care of her children, and of course you would know that the end result, lack of education, lack of food, lack of good wealth, good lifestyle, and so on. The sexual assaults on women, rape, when we were growing on as teenagers, as kids, they used to tell us, one of the reasons, one of the things that you need to open up the sexual relations between men and women is to reduce sexual assault on women, is to reduce the rape. Because if everybody can have whatever he wants without any restrictions, then why should there be a rape? Look at the statistics. It is definitely not so. The more you open up, the worse it becomes. So in between 2008, 2002 to 2010, 11, those are the statistics in the United States. Those are the United States where the number of sexual assaults were always above 200,000. This is very large amount of rape and sexual assaults on women. That is an ill social structure. That's not some social structure where you can trust your wife, your mother, or your daughter, or your sister to be living in. And then goes with teenage pregnancy, decreasing of marriage rates, and all of these issues. There is one more thing which I always, now, here is a video I wanted to play, but I don't think we have the time, so that it will not be Abu Talha who is saying it is a program done in the United Kingdom by director of women affairs and interviewing some local women, where she almost cries saying that we cannot afford to continue living like this lifestyle. Woman is abused almost all over domestic violence is growing, rape is becoming epidemic. There is no solution out of this problem. There is a mess. It's epidemic. So that's the bottom line, or the summary of this YouTube video, is that social structure in the West, it's an epidemic problem. It's not something that you can address and solve through elections or through legislations. It has become part of the structure. Look at pornography. Pornography, it makes annually, these from 2008 or 2009 statistics, more than $14 billion, the revenue out of selling illegal, bad type of movies, ideas, advertisement, and all of this. That's L. Sexually transmitted diseases. The curves, just look at the curves, they are increasing. This is over time. This is I think, what's this? This is the chlamydia. Chlamydia, it's increasing. Syphilis, it's almost steady. And then other type, this is syphilis, it's actually growing. And the number of people, AIDS, I think this is AIDS. AIDS is another epidemic type of problem, although in the United States and Europe, it's a little bit less severe than it's in Africa or in other places. But nevertheless, when you say more than almost 619,000 people have died, and about 1.2 million people, adults, are currently living with HIV, that's bad. That's bad. You don't need that. You don't need to have that. Now it's epidemic. You cannot reduce it. You cannot take care of it. You will just have to accept the fact. You have to look for cure. You have to look for all types of resolutions. You don't need that. People do not need to live with AIDS. People do not necessarily live, and therefore, by a de facto, they must have syphilis or gonorrhea or any other type of STD. It's not right. It's not a fact of life. They tell us poverty is a fact of life. We can only reduce its impact. They tell us that STD is a fact of life. That's not true. STD is not a fact of life. It is dependent on the social system. Don't use a social system the way you are using it, and then you will not have this epidemic. You will solve the problem altogether. And that's what Islam did. So let me go back now in the last 10 minutes here, which is unfortunate, we should be spending more time. But usually, I think it's okay to spend time to realize the magnitude of the problem. For us and for the people around us, we have to realize that the magnitude of the social diseases and illnesses is huge. It's big. The HIV, the syphilis, the STDs, the teenage pregnancies, the divorce rate, the violence, the assault, the rape, and all, it's epidemic, it's a problem. So the more you are convinced it's a problem, the more you try to look for the solution, and the more the solution becomes valuable. Otherwise, if I give you a ton of gold, and you don't know that this gold is a precious material, and you need a precious material, probably you would throw it in the garbage. So until and unless you realize the need for something I am giving you, you may not take it seriously. So that's the reason we say, let's look at this and make sure that we understand the epidemic of the problem, so that the solution, the introduction of the Islamic solution becomes vital, becomes something important, becomes something that the people really love to see. They love to hear and they want to see. Now, as I said, Islam, right from the very beginning, coming to the Islamic social system, what is it based on? Number one, how does Islam view woman? She is a servant of Allah. Allah says, إِنَّ الْمُسْلِمِينَ وَالْمُسْلِمَاتِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ الْقَانِتِينَ وَالْقَانِتَاتِ الصَّادِقِينَ وَالصَّادِقَاتِ الصَّابِرِينَ وَالصَّابِرَاتِ الْخَاشِعِينَ وَالْخَاشِعَاتِ Every good quality that Allah Azza wa Jal wants to see, He says, applies and pertains to man and woman. Man and woman. All of them. Muslim, mu'min, qanit, qanita. So that is a very major view and very fundamental thing that we need to understand. Then Islam says the woman is not only a woman, she is a mother. And a mother with the highest level of respect. When Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says that the heavens, the paradise, are under the feet of a mother. That is raising the level of a mother to the highest standard. So a mother, when someone says in this country, it has become like an insult to say that this is a woman who is a mother caring for a children and a housewife. You better say something else. Mother is not an issue that people should be ashamed of. A mother in Islam, Allah Azza wa Jalla raised it up to the highest level. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when somebody told him, Ya Rasulullah, man ahaqqun nas bi sohbati? Who is the best person to be my companion? He said, Ummuka thumma ummuka thumma ummuk. Your mother, then your mother, then your mother. Meaning that your mother is at the highest level. When someone came to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and said, Ya Rasulullah, my mother has become disabled, and I carry my mother all the way to do Hajj with her around the Kaaba, in the Safa and Marwa and so on. What does that mean for me? Isn't that equivalent to the fact that she carried me in her womb and she took care of me when I was young? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam smiled at him and said, you know, there is a major difference between you and your mother. Your mother cared for you when you were little. She was growing you up to see you a living human being. And you are carrying your mother every day. You say she will die tomorrow because she's too old. I'm carrying you now. Okay, I will manage until you die. And she would say, I will manage until you live. That's how the mother is. And that's the level the Islam came for the woman. And then the Islam made the woman with honor. The honor of a woman, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam equated the honor of the woman to the significance of the land and the wealth and the money and the most precious things, to the extent that if someone fights in order to protect his wife, his daughter, his sister, his cousin, his Muslim sister from an enemy who is going to attack here, then you could be a martyr. A martyr. In a society like the society we see today, people see women raped in front of their eyes. And I still remember as a young kid when I was growing as a teenager, they had this episode on TV where a woman was raped on a pool table time after time, and people were chanting and looking at her, and those who did not like that, they could not do anything because, oh, they said, we will be beaten up. In Islam, you say, don't worry about being beaten or dying because you go shaheed. If you protect a Muslim woman, then you are shaheed. Imagine now how many Muslim women today are being violated, their honor are being violated, and our Muslim ummah are not even eager to be that shaheed. That is very important to remember. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made defending and fighting for a woman is of highest value. And then Islam did not look at the woman as a sex subject, as an object of sex. A woman is a human, is a person. In fact, just usually I mentioned this and I forget it tonight. The word woman in Islam is not derivative of man. It's not woman, it's imra'ah. And a rajul, insan has two branches. Insan is insan. Al-rajul and al-mar'ah. Rajul is man and mar'ah is woman. Rajul and mar'ah are not derivative of the same thing. And this is what the Quran used. Not like the other languages which do not give this this concern about the plight of woman herself. So Islam now, to prevent the woman from being an object of sex, he told her, when you go out to deal with people, in the market, in the political aspect, in fighting and whatever, you go out as a human. And nothing of your sexuality should be part of that equation. That's why you cover. That's why the woman goes out, she covers her hair, she covers her body, she goes out and deals as a person. She doesn't go with short skirts, with shorts, with all her chest up, exposed, and then that's not dealing with a human. That's dealing with a sex object. And just look at the advertisements for Toyota or Datsun or GM or cigarettes. All those advertisements, they come with nice, beautiful, half-naked women in order to advertise for a product that has nothing to do with women. Islam does not allow that. Now, so There is a hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, and this is important to mention it. We, especially here in this hall, we are men, many of us are married, we have wives, we have mothers. The Prophet ﷺ has this hadith, مَا أَهَانَهُنَّ إِلَّا لَئِيمٌ وَمَا أَكْرَمَهُنَّ إِلَّا كَرِيمٌ. Anyone who insults the woman, anyone who makes bad gesture to his wife or to the woman, then he's la'im, that's wicked. That's wicked. وَمَا أَكْرَمَهُنَّ. If you are good to your wife, with treat her with honor, then you are kareem. So a kareem is a person who deals with the woman in an honorable manner. A la'im, a wicked, he deals in a wicked manner. And then comes the real solutions now. The woman doesn't go out half naked or quarter naked or naked at all. The woman is not a sex object, but you need to create this relationship. Then you have the marriage. Then you have marriage. And the marriage is an actual contract between men and women based on Islam. There is this solution which is called marriage. And marriage, Allah Azza wa Jal did not call it partnership. Because some people, they think of it as partnership, helping one another. It's not. It is a second. لِتَسْكُنُوا إِلَيْهَا. Allah says, وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ أَنْ خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَنْفُسِكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا لِتَسْكُنُوا إِلَيْهَا. One of the signs of Allah Azza wa Jal, of His greatness, of His wisdom, of His existence, that He created from among us mates and couples so that we had this second. A second is derivative of sakina. And sakina is harmony. Is something decent, decency, some life that's quiet, that is not disturbed. As-sakina is something that is not disturbed. وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةً وَرَحْمَةً. And Allah Azza wa Jal made this happen such that there is love and mercy among them. So the issue of love and mercy is part of this marriage. So this marriage is not, oh, we get married and then I pay you this much, you pay me this much, and if you, at some point, if we quarrel or we go home and you'll find all types of disaster at home, that's not marriage. Allah Azza wa Jal wants the marriage to be sakina, to be mawadda, to be rahmah. And then He made this, that this is something for people to wonder on. لِقَوْمٍ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ. And the divorce is a solution to a problem. And not only a solution, Allah Azza wa Jal, He specifically mentioned in the Quran that if you perform a talaq between you and the woman, then you either allow this woman to stay bil ma'roof, if divorce doesn't go through, then you should not be so bad or aggressive against her. وَلَا تُمْسِكُهُنَّ ضِرَارًا. And sometimes you're not, I'm not going to divorce you until and unless you let go of your mahr or dowry. ضِرَارًا. Against her interest. So Allah Azza wa Jal, He made this issue of talaq to be especially in the interest of woman, because the talaq is done by the man. Therefore He wanted that talaq to be in the interest of the woman. فَأَمْسِكُوهُنَّ بِمَعْرُوفٍ أَوْ سَرِّحُوهُنَّ بِمَعْرُوفٍ وَلَا تَمْسِكُوهُنَّ ضِرَارًا لِتَعْتَدُوا. Do not be aggressive against this woman. And there are many other places in the Quran this issue is repeated. And then the issues of parenthood. Because marriage and this life is not only two getting together. You get together, you become parents. You have your own parents. So parenthood in Islam is something that Allah Azza wa Jal made it one step below the worship of Allah Azza wa Jal. You all know in Surah Al-Isra where He says, وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّهِ وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. Allah decreed that you worship Him alone. However, you have to be absolutely good to your parents. وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. فَأَمَّا يَبْلُغَنَّ عِنْدَكَ الْكِبَرَ أَحَدُهُمَا أَوْ كِلَاهُمَا. When someone becomes old, one of them or both, don't take them to senior houses. He doesn't say take them out of your home. فَإِمَّا يَبْلُغَنَّ عِنْدَكَ الْكِبَرَ أَحَدُهُمَا أَوْ كِلَاهُمَا فَلَا تَقُلْ لَهُمَا أُفْ. Number one, don't even say off to them. Don't say wow to them. Don't give them an expression that you are a little bit bored of them. وَلَا تَقُلْ لَهُمَا أُفْ. وَلَا تَنْهَرْهُمَا. Do not give them any bad sign, any bad wording from you. وَقُلْ لَهُمَا قَوْلًا كَرِيمًا. Be very gentle, very nice of your words. وَاخْفُضْ لَهُمَا جَنَاحَ الذُّلِّ مِنَ الرَّحْمَةِ. Be humiliated to them out of mercy. Allah Azza wa Jal did not ask us to have humility except to our parents. Unfortunately, some of people, they treat their parents like worse than they treat strangers. Motherhood, I mentioned already about how much motherhood. And then there is Salat al-Rahm. Islam did not recognize the marriage, only man and woman getting together, let's organize their relations. There is a Rahm. Rahm means relationships that extend beyond myself, my wife, my father, my mother. It's a relationship that goes to my wife, my father, my mother, her aunts, my mother. So it's a whole tree of things. And Allah Azza wa Jal, He mentioned that the Arsh al-Rahman, the Arsh, the throne of al-Rahman, mu'allaqun bil-Rahm. It is tightly coupled to al-Rahm. Al-Rahm, by the way, the word al-Rahm, for those who don't understand Arabic, al-Rahm comes from the word the womb of the mother. It's the same. And al-Rahmah, al-Rahm and al-Rahmah, and al-Rahm, all of these are derivatives of the same thing, or they have the same root. So any relationship that comes through the mother, through the woman, is called Rahm. Anything that comes through my mother, through my daughter, through my sister, even through my aunts, all of these branches, these are our Rahm, which we are responsible for. And the lastly, I know Brother Hussein is here.
Well, that's okay, go for 10 more minutes.
The nafaqah, support, financial support. In Islam, the mother as a mother, the sister as a sister, the daughter as a daughter, the wife as a wife, in other words, the woman as one of these categories, each one of these categories, there is a responsibility for financial support. No matter how rich the woman is, she does not have to suffer or get the pain of working late night shifts. Yesterday I was with Brother Abu Bakr here. We were stopped at late after the session of our tafsir in Masjid al-Huda to pick up something from a store. And then at the end of the exit of the store, there is an older woman, probably she's in her 60s or maybe more. She's just checking receipts. It's almost 11:30 at night. You know, it reminds me, Brother Abu Bakr, subhanAllah, this woman needed the Khilafah or the Islamic State to save her this time, or she needed Islam, to protect her, to feed her, to give her whatever she needs, so she doesn't have to stand at the inn at midnight just checking the people's receipt and getting maybe $6 or $7 an hour, maybe not even enough to feed herself. In Islam, no woman has the need or the requirement to work in order to feed herself or to be in charge of her children. It is always incumbent upon the husband, the parent, the brother, or the son. One of these must take care, and if none of them exist or all of them are poor, then the Islamic State will take care of that, or the zakah will take care of that, or the public property will take care of that. In Islam, a woman goes out to earn some money for her own self, with her own liking, not because she has to, not because of the life pressure upon her. She doesn't have that pressure. And then al-mirah, the last thing, which is one of the most beloved topic I like to talk about, because people, they usually tell us, oh, woman in Islam, Allah Azza wa Jalla in the Quran says the woman inherits half as much as the male does. وَلِلذَّكَرِ مِثْلُ حَظِّ الْأُنْثَيَيْنِ. That is, that's not just. Okay, if you count two better more than one, of course, two more than one. But then I say, there is no single society in the world, no single ideology in the world, not even democracy, not capitalism, not any of them that designates a portion to the woman, whether it's one third or one half or two twice or three times. Zero. What this means, in this society, in America today, if I leave all my will, I have 10 daughters and a son, and I say all my wealth will go to my son. Can I do that? By law. Yes, I can. By law, I can. And none of the daughters will get anything. Not my mother, not my wife, nobody. I can make my will to a dog. and leave everybody out. Islam said, wait a second, I must make sure and guarantee that the woman takes a share. As a husband, as a wife, she takes 1/8 of the whatever is left from the husband. As a daughter, she takes from her father half of what the males take. As a mother, she takes from the son. So she has portion of the inheritance as a wife, as a mother, as a daughter, and also as a sister in case the brother doesn't have any children, or his parents are dead also. So she does take from all of these. Not only that, when the daughter or when the woman, she gets part of the inheritance from her family side, and now she is dependent on her husband. Her husband is the one who takes care of her. He's the one who pays her the dowry. He's the one who pays all the nafaqa, and he is the one who is in charge. Nevertheless, she brings to the family of her husband part of the inheritance from her father. So all in all, the mirath in Islam, the mirath did not jeopardize or did not go unjustly against the woman. In fact, it is computed. When you compute it all, you will find it's all comes out to equilibrium or something that's a valid formula. You can never come up with a formula like this. If you take into consideration the fact that I am not going to spend my money on myself or on my children, I'm not going to pay part of the rent, I'm not going to pay part of my house or my transportation, but I will get money from my father who has passed away and left me $100,000. Those $100,000, I bring it to my husband or to my family or to my children without me needing to spend any money on them, without me being responsible. So that's the whole issue of mirath in Islam, is that Islam is the only, currently the only ideology that exists in the world, the only religion, the only system that specifically leaves something specific for the woman. No one can argue with that. No one can argue with that. Every other system today does not recognize the rights of people for inheritance, whether male or female. It's unjust for all. Islam is just for all. And I would like to stop right here. Jazakumullahu khairan. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Brothers, and I'm sorry if I took more time than
you. Now I open the floor for questions and inshallah. I'll recognize the first hand and then the second and so on. Yes.
Yes, you know, you mentioned Aisha radiallahu anha, she's, you know, mentioned some hadith or something coming in. But, you know, Aisha radiallahu anha, she said about hadith was in
the Well, the hadith of Aisha radiallahu anha, she narrated, she counted the types of marriages or illegal marriages that were happening in the society of the Arabs before Islam. She talked about al-istibba, which I called it genetic improvement. She called about ashab al-rayat, the ones with the flags, and she mentioned the al-rahd, which is the people who come and have illegal relation with a woman, and then the father becomes by selection. One of them will be you toss a coin, and then the coin says, oh, this X person is the father. So that's the hadith of the Aisha radiallahu anha.
Yes.
Assalamu alaikum. Alhamdulillah, very nice speech. My question is, you mentioned the problems and the answer, which is Islam itself. But how are we going to bring this in this real world?
Okay. It's a good question, brother. The answer, the solution is multi-parts. One has to do with perspective and values and the views. And the perspective and the value and the views, this is something that we can disseminate, we can talk about, we can discuss, we can put it outside to the people of the world so they would know. But then the ones that have to do with rules, like the rules of marriage, the rules of divorce, the rules of against fornication and adultery, the rules for the dress code. Those require legislation. A legislation means a state. It does require a state that will adopt them. These are not something that will be done for, that will be left for the individual to accept or reject. Those are things which you have to adhere to based on legislation. So when the Prophet, when Allah Azza wa Jal revealed the ayah for hijab to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the Quran, that tell your wives and the wife of the believers to cover themselves, يُدْنِينَ عَلَيْهِنَّ مِنْ جَلَابِيبِهِنَّ وَيَضْرِبْنَ عَلَى خُمُورِهِنَّ عَلَى جُوبِهِنَّ بِخُمُورِهِنَّ. Let them bring their julbab down all the way from the neck down, and then let them wrap up their chest, upper chest, with their scarves. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Sahaba, they went out in the Medina loudly speaking that this new revelation has been revealed, and therefore women will not be allowed to walk out in the street until and unless they have this dress. So somebody has to be in charge, and that is where the Muslim Ummah today, what we lack, and in fact, let me, we lack the implementation of Islam based on Islam. A few years ago, I was with this interview on the radio, on NPR, with a woman who wrote an article called Woman in Veil, Muslim Woman in Veil. And here, gesture or the premise is that in Islam, within the Muslim societies, Muslim women are oppressed. They don't get their rights. And they are abused. And they are given into marriage without their consent. Which is not, of course, in Islam it's not true. So I had to debate that woman. In the debate, there is, now, I cannot deny the fact that there is oppression in the Muslim world against women. Well, there is oppression against men as well. So women are not the only ones who are oppressed. Oppression is against all. But then, the things that pertain to women, my challenge was, look, those Muslim societies, they are not living according to the Islamic rules. That is why every time you see someone oppressed, whether man or woman, inside the Muslim world, it's not because of Islam, it's despite the fact that Islam is not implemented. So it's not the implementation of Islam that brings the oppression and the chaos, it's the lack of the implementation of Islam. So today the Muslim world, more than anything else, is not encouraged, but it's required, it must bring an Islamic model, it must implement the social system among other systems of Islam so that we can present the model to the world. But until we do that, we still can talk about the model. Because sometimes someone would come and tell me, what good does it do if you don't have that system in existence? Well, what good did it do when Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was in Mecca and the Islamic system was not implemented? He condemned az-zina. And Islam condemned burying the daughters alive. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not have the ability to enforce the rules, but nevertheless, he had the ability to convey his message and to talk about it. And when he had the opportunity to implement his system in Medina, then he provided the world with a model. So that's what we do today. Now we continue to discuss and talk and convince this is the right model to go through, and then until we bring this model to implementation.
Yes.
But what do you call Saudi Arabia, this sort of program, where they're enforcing hijab on women only, so...
Well, look, the social system in Islam is not only the hijab. Hijab is only part of it. It suffices to say, for some reason or another, yesterday I had the same question about Saudi Arabia. I don't know why people are insisting on asking. Anyway, it suffices to say that a Saudi woman, by the Saudi law, is not allowed to marry a non-Saudi. Although he could be a Muslim from India or Pakistan or somewhere, she would be punished. She would be punished. She's not allowed to do that. You cannot sign a marriage contract in Saudi Arabia. If you go there and work as an engineer or something, and you are, mashallah, good looking and nice, and you want to marry the daughter of your boss, and she wants you and they want you, you cannot do that. It's not allowed. That's not the social system in Islam. Social system in Islam, Allah Azza wa Jal, in fact, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, this issue of so-called same class, same sect, Islam dissolved that. And we know how. We know when Zaynab bin Jahsh from Bani Hashim, she married Zayd bin Harith, who was supposedly the adopted son or a previous slave of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Although it was now this is Allah's knowledge that Zaynab eventually will be the wife of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but nevertheless the marriage did go through. This is not, that's just to say, there is many other things. I don't want to spend the night talking about Saudi Arabia, but that in itself is sufficient to say the social system in Islam is not implemented in Saudi Arabia. Yes?
How are the youth supposed to interact with the opposite genders in the general public?
Okay, that's a good question. In the general public, the other gender, we deal with them on the merit of the transaction that is required to take place. For example, students. I am a student. I meet I talk to a girl who is a student. I do that as a student, not as a male versus female. Male versus female. When it comes male versus female, the gender relations, then they have to be out of the equation. The moment. And this is all of us, all the adult ones, we have been youth, and we went through that. The moment the interaction or the transaction starts becoming genderly, then that's no longer a student to a student. That's no longer, let's say if I am in the market, I have a store. A woman comes to buy from my store, she's a woman, and I am a man. Okay, she buys, I give her the product, she handles the money, she asks questions, I help as human to human. The moment that starts becoming a little bit more into male to female, then that is not allowed transaction. That interaction is not allowed. So this is the whole issue of the so-called ikhtilat, mixture in Islam. Islam allowed men and women to mix in public places because public places are places to execute transactions which are non-gender based. That's why we do have the mixture in the market, in the factory, in the shops, in the street, and all of these, and you interact with women, the women interact with men to perform the transactions which are legal. But the moment start talking about the so-called genderly things, then that's not allowed. Yes.
What about a congratulatory handshake or something like that?
Well, handshake is an issue of dispute among the scholars. There are many scholars who have the view that it's not allowed. Some they think it is allowed with some dalils. The recommendation in a society that we live in to the women, to the sisters, abstain from that. Even you know it's allowed. Let's say if you adopt the opinion it's allowed. My opinion, leave 70% of the allowed for taqwa. The Sahaba of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they used to abandon 70 baban min abwab al mubah wara'an. They would leave 70% portions of what is mubah to them wara. Just I don't need the trouble. So irrespective of whether it's based on whose opinion is, I would say just you don't need that.
Abstain, yes.
Yes.
According to his question too, wouldn't that apply? I mean, saying that even though it's mubah, it's okay to do, don't do it just so you don't open the door. Then the same thing, and don't even sit with the girl as a student, because Muhammad says the shaitan is the third, you know, so why take the chance? Yes. You know, I mean, I'll rather go sit with a guy, you know, so I don't have that risk. You know, forget the degree if I'm going to make a mistake, you know what I mean? Don't sit with a girl.
Well, you are right. Anything that's mubah, which is Allah, if that would lead me to something that I would be tempted, because I know myself, if that would lead me to any temptation, I would abandon, I would leave. Yes, true. So that's, it applies to anything that's mubah. When we say the Sahaba, they left not only 10%, 70%, wara'an, because anything that distracts, anything that can make you forget, anything that can make you do a mistake, anything that allows you to be in trouble later on, don't do that. But we don't generalize things. Mubah remains mubah, haram remains haram, and whatever is not allowed is not allowed. That's, but the main point is we have to be conscious, we have to be aware, what is it that I want to do? And by the way, just with the brother question and your follow-up, that tells us the fact that we, the Muslims, we somehow end up in living in total chaotic societies, that puts burden on our shoulders. It's not easy. It's not easy for me to grow as a young man studying at age of 17 or 18 in the old Soviet Union with communism, where everything is free and everything is absolutely absurd. It's not easy. Now, why would I do that? Well, because there is some idiot rulers in our countries who ripped off the whole countries and did not build education systems and forced the youngs to go and get education in such places. And not to implement, and going back to the same thing the brother was mentioning there. So the same thing, when we have about 10, 15 million or 10 million people living in absolutely so-called liberal free societies, and then we try, oh, this kid be careful, or this one be careful, and don't talk there, don't go there, that is big burden upon us. That's big burden. That is what we have missed by missing the Islamic society or the society of Islam, where Islam is the protector, where Islam is a ra'i, where Islam is the shepherd, where Islam is the one that takes care of its sheep, of its people, of its belongings. Now, we have in the Muslim world, we have wolves that evicted people out, and they told them, go out and live with the wolves, and then till you survive.
Yes. Usually sometimes we see that there are certain things that are pointed out, especially from the Quran, that women are treated badly. And one of the most common ayahs is from Surah Nisa, ayah number 34, where it says, وَضْرِبُوهُنَّ, or beat them. And this is usually used as to indicate that we are allowed to beat women, and it's used as a thing to say that Islam is oppressive to women. So if you could comment on that ayah.
Yes. Well, this ayah in Surah An-Nisa, and it's explained by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in hadith, which is narrated by Aisha radiallahu anha, where he says, Allah Azza wa Jal, he brought this as a solution for the women that are about to abandon the house or to destroy the house, called وَاللَّئِ تَخَافُونَ نُشُوزَهُمْ. You are afraid that those will be nushuz. And nushuz means it's someone who is disturbing the quietness or the coherency of the house. So if the woman is about to do that disturbance, and it's specifically saying it's she is the one responsible for the disturbance, then do the following treatment. And the Prophet ﷺ said, in this case, it is you do that so that you don't leave a brow, you don't leave a mark, you don't hurt, you don't leave a pain. It is just to show that you are serious about the fact that you want to straighten out the problem. So in essence, even if you take this as one of the norms, one of the things that Islam allows to do, in comparison to realities, it's almost negligible. Especially when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam defined that, and he said, the Aisha radiallahu anha says he would use his miswak, which is like a brush, miswak to brush the shoulder of the woman to tell her, don't do that again. So that's because the word darb hit. You would say darb means kill, darb means punch, darb means do something like this. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned that it's this type of darb that is allowed.
I have two comments. First one is, because since we're talking about the social system in Islam and talking about the human rights, maybe they have a question.
Okay, let's give you a question.
One comment about this, the shoes. This dark thing, I don't think it comes like the first option. Islam gives the man to do the deed after like certain steps. That will come maybe at the end of these steps.
Any sister who has a question, please. I don't know how.
They do have a question, or okay, I will understand. Go ahead, sister. Or if you want to send it in writing, it's up to you.
Assalamu
alaikum. Alaykum
assalam. I have two questions. One is, just because more problems come from personal freedom, is that a good enough excuse to turn to God? Why can't I just say I'll be careful with the choices I make and I'm not giving up my personal freedoms? That's my first question.
Well, in Islam, the personal freedom, as a definition, the freedom is the thing which is defined as a mubah. Okay, that's what freedom is in Islam. What is free, I am free to do what is a mubah. Mubah means it is Islam made a decree that this act is allowed. So once I know that this is a mubah, then it's up to me, I will use my own discretion to do it or not to do it. So the so-called, the scope of freedom is within the mubah. Within the mubah, yes, do whatever you want. Whatever you think is good for you, is right for you, as a mubah. But if it's a wajib, for example, or a haram, for example, it's a wajib to cover the body. It's a wajib. That's not personal freedom. It's a fard. This is not an area where, now within that, the what type of color you choose, what type of style, what type of things, that's up to you. But the wajib is to cover. That's not something where you will say, okay, it's my personal freedom, I want to cover or not cover. So we cannot do that.
What's your next question, sister?
Second question.
Okay. How can you prove it to a non-Muslim that you're really not oppressed by all the rules?
Well, whether it's oppressed or not, it's a matter of regulation. What we are saying is, at least now this is Islam, and we invite all people to accept that, is that the sexual relationships outside marriage, without a valid marriage, are not allowed. We don't want people to, Islam does not want people to get engaged in genderly type of relationships until and unless they are married. Now what Islam did, whether the young people they live in Western societies or not, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he encouraged, he said, يَا مَعْشَرَ الشَّبَابِ مَنْ اسْتَطَاعَ مِنْكُمُ الْبَاءَةَ فَلْيَتَزَوَّجْ. O young men, or if you have the ability to get married, then get married. Don't wait until you are age 25 or 26. There is nothing in Islam, or in fact in the world, that would say, if I become teenager, then I have to suffer from age 14 until age 24 or 25, or all of this suffer and pain until I have my gender relationship. That's not right. In Islam, that is not the way to do it. Now, unfortunately, as I said, when Islam is not implemented, when we don't have the rules of Islam, then people live in poverty, people cannot support themselves, then there are all types of burdens upon the people in order to build a home or to sustain a family. That is all uncalled for. And the reason that the young men and women whether in this society or other societies, they do suffer and they have the pain, especially those who really abstain from illegal relationship, is because Islam is absent. When Islam is not absent, then those things, number one, the temptation that goes on the street will not be there, which means the provocative actions from both men and women will disappear. And then when the needs rise, when people, they start understanding their own needs, Islam says, get married. Now, if the dowry is too much, Islam says, أَكْثَرُهُنَّ بَرَكَةً أَقَلُّهُنَّ مُهُورًا, or the ones with the least dowry are the best of the barakah, and then get the support. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in a hadith says, ثَلَاثَةٌ حَقٌ عَلَى اللَّهِ عَوْنُهُمْ, Allah Azza wa Jal vows to help three types, categories of people. One of them, ناكحٌ يريد العفاف, person who wants to get married because he wants to protect himself. Now when the Prophet says Allah helps him, it means that you Muslim should provide from the zakah, from the support, from the help to provide help for that brother. It's not that, oh, Allah Azza wa Jal will send an angel to take this person and have a wedding for him. That's not what it means. When it says, ثَلَاثَةٌ حَقٌ عَلَى اللَّهِ عَوْنُهُمْ, Allah is determined to help three categories of people. One of them, نَاكِحٌ يُرِيدُ الْعَفَافِ, and the second one, طالب العلم, the one who wants, looks for علم, and the third one is مُجَاهِدٌ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ, the one who goes out in the jihad fi sabilillah. So that's the idea, is our young men and women, they need the implementation of Islam, they need the rules of Islam, so that they live in harmony and they do not live in suffering and pain. Jazakum Allahu khayran wa assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Thank you, brothers. Catch my flight.
Thank you very much. I would like to thank our learned speaker on behalf of the community and the audience here. It's very difficult for us to part with our learned speaker because he has to catch the flight, so we will excuse him. We wish he could have spent, the original plan was he would spend another hour with us, but he has to leave, so inshallah, may Allah reward you and make your journey easy and successful, and inshallah we will benefit again soon with your scholarship and your experience.
Inshallah. Jazakallah.